Welcome to Blossoming by Grace and Grit. This is message 579. The name of our devotional today is A Royal Priesthood. But first, let us pray. Father God, thank you so much, my Lord. Thank you, my Father, for your amazing love and forgiveness. My Lord God, your tenderness towards us, the tenderness of your heart, my Father, never ceases to amaze me. How you bring people together, how you show us a book, a verse, a journal where we wrote something years ago. And at some point in time, you prompt us to open that journal and to go to that page. My Lord, you have a way of leading us and speaking to us and directing us, and it is absolutely amazing. Where would we be if we didn't have you in the land of the living? And the Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. And this command contains an invitation to experience the presence, your presence in our life. It also contains a promise, Father, that the more we experience you, the more convinced we are of your goodness. My Lord, this knowledge is essential to our faith walk. Because when adversities strike, the human condition, our instincts, is always to doubt your goodness, Father. But you say, my ways are mysterious. Even to those who know me intimately, my ways are not your ways, says the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways and thoughts higher than your ways and thoughts. My Lord, I've given up trying to fathom your ways. I will never understand, my God. For your mind, there is an infinite power, an infinite essence that we can never understand, for you see things from the beginning to the end and everything in between, and therefore, how can we understand something, Father God, when you are seeing into the future, maybe 10 years into the future. Instead, we need to really enjoy spending the time with you instead of trying to figure you out, because we will never really understand or really figure you out, even if we live 1,000 years. The many facets of your personality, the many different aspects of your character, my Father. But for today, for right now, we will spend time enjoying you and experiencing your goodness. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. A royal priesthood is found in Scripture. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. 1 Peter 2:9 is a powerful declaration of our identity in Christ. The Apostle Peter reminds us that as believers, we are more than just followers of Christ. We are chosen by God, set apart as a royal priesthood, and called to live out our purpose in a way that glorifies Him. The phrase, "You are a chosen people," highlights the intentionality of God in selecting us for His purposes. We do not stumble into this identity by accident. We are chosen by God to be a part of His family. The truth should fill us with gratitude and a sense of purpose. We are not ordinary. We are hand-picked by the Creator of the universe. As a royal priesthood, we carry both the authority of royalty and the responsibility of priests. In the Old Testament, priests were the mediators between God and the people, offering sacrifices and prayers on behalf of others. Today, as royal priests, we have direct access to God through Jesus Christ and are called to intercede for others, offering spiritual sacrifices and living lives that reflect God's kingdom. Being a holy nation means we are set apart for God's purposes. Holiness is not just about moral purity, but about being dedicated to God and His will. As part of His holy nation, we are called to live differently from the world, embodying the values of the kingdom of God in everything we do. We are God's treasured possession, deeply loved and valued by Him. This identity gives us security and confidence, knowing that we belong to God and are cared for by Him. It also motivates us to live in a way that honors Him as we are His representatives on earth. Our identity as a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, and God's special possession is not just for our benefit. It is so that we may declare the praises of Him who called us out of darkness into His wonderful light. Our lives should be a testimony to the goodness, grace, and power of God, shining His light into the world. Reflect on your identity as part of God's royal priesthood. How does this truth shape the way you see yourself and your purpose? Are there areas in your life where you need to embrace your royal priesthood more fully, perhaps in how you intercede with others or how you represent God to those around you? We have so many different choices to be the total opposite of a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a chosen generation by God. The world is full of choices that are ungodly, and we have the choice to choose God or to choose the world. Today, I encourage you and I remind you that choosing God is choosing life. Choosing God is choosing peace and mercies and grace and forgiveness and love and direction and wisdom. It's choosing God and everything that He embodies. When we choose Him, He comes running to us and He opens His arms wide open, like He did to the prodigal son, to His son, to that son that had asked for his inheritance before time. He had asked for all his money, and he went to the city and he spent the money in easy living, drinking and partying. And one day he found himself in the pigsty and he looked around and he said, "My father's servants live better than I do." And he received the revelation to return home. And he was walking towards his home. And his father saw him from far away. And his father started running towards him. with unconditional love. There were no reproaches, no demands, just unconditional love. A coat, a special coat that symbolized a royal priesthood, a fatted calf, which symbolized a celebration. And the father ran to the son without looking back, without any judgment as to what the son had done with his inheritance. He had squandered everything, yet God looked at him with love and compassion. And the father symbolizes God. The father is a foreshadow of God. And that's what God does with us. It doesn't matter the mistakes that we've done. His mercy and His grace is always for us. Of course, each mistake and each sin, each behavior and action, there will be a consequence, because that is the way that the principles of life and the rules and the laws of life are made. So God forgives us, but there are still consequences to be paid. And of course, God will always protect us, and He will always embrace us and basically shield us. And when we truly repent from our heart and we ask forgiveness for whatever that thing is, whatever it's a sin or a mistake or whatever it is, we repent from our heart, God is faithful to forgive us. And I believe that there is a softer landing for the children of God than for the people in the world, because that is what mercy and grace is all about. And so remember, never take advantage or take the blood of Jesus or the cross and what He did and His sacrifice and the forgiveness that He provides through His death, never take it for granted. And remember that we are not just any person. We are not just any people. We are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. The Bible says that we are peculiar peoples, transferred from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of His Son's light. And that makes us peculiar to the world, to those that are perishing, and to those that are walking in the darkness. For what does light and the darkness have in common? They have nothing in common. And that is why when you're in the light and you surround yourself with people that are in the darkness, you have nothing in common. There is this, it is like a pressure. It is like something like a very discomfort. It's an uncomfortable feeling that you can't put your finger on it, but yet in the spiritual realm, it is very understandable. But the Bible explains it. What does the light have to do with the darkness? And that is why sometimes we are rejected when we come to Christ by the people of the world, by our families, even our friends, because our light exposes their darkness, exposes their sins. And there will come a time that they might not stand to be around us. Of course, if they're your family, it would probably not be the same way. But they, people that are not in Christ, they feel uncomfortable around us because we talk different, we behave different, we think different, we don't do things like we used to do before Christ saved us. So they might feel uncomfortable that you're not swearing anymore, or they might feel uncomfortable that you're not talking dirty talk innuendos about sex, or that those are just examples. They might feel uncomfortable that you're not going to the clubs anymore. So all of those things, they are a reality. But as a chosen people, as a chosen generation, as a royal priesthood and a holy nation, we have a great responsibility to the Lord. A great responsibility. So let us go forth to today reflecting our identity as part of God's royal priesthood. And let us go into our lives and into our sphere of influence, showing the world what light looks like, what a person that has been set free because they have known the truth and the truth sets him free, what does that look like? Let us reflect those qualities. So we will embrace our royal priesthood more fully. How we intercede for others and how we represent God to all around us. May our identity glorify God today and always. Heavenly Father, thank you for choosing us and calling us your royal priesthood. We are humbled and we are grateful to be part of your holy nation, set apart for your purposes. Help us to live out our identity in a way that glorifies you, my Father. May our lives be a testimony of your grace as we declare your praises and shine your light in the world. Strengthen us to fulfill the responsibilities of our royal priesthood, my Father, representing your kingdom with integrity and with love. In Jesus' mighty, precious name, we love you and we thank you. And we praise you today and every day. Amen. My friend, I encourage you to play in the light, play in the sunshine, and dance in the rain. Remember that God loves you so very, very much. Also remember to stay grateful. Until we meet again, God bless you. This is a prayer to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Father God, thank you so much, my Lord, for Jesus. Thank you so much that I realize that I am a sinner and that I need a Savior, God. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the precious blood that was shed on the cross at Calvary for me, for my sins. Lord Jesus, I ask you forgiveness for every one of my sins. I ask you, Lord Jesus, to come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I give you my word that from this day forward, I will follow you. I will read the word, I will go to church, and I will spend time with you, Lord Jesus. I want to get to know you more. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for making something of my life that is worthwhile, something wonderful. Thank you, Lord, for accepting me as your son, as your daughter, into the kingdom of God. Thank you, Lord, for your love, for your great grace. In your name I pray, Lord Jesus. Thank you for receiving me today. Amen. My friend, if you have made this prayer, if you have said this prayer, I congratulate you because today there is a celebration in heaven. The Bible says that when one sinner repents, there is a celebration. In other words, there is a party in the kingdom of God. And so I congratulate you because it is the absolute best decision that you will ever make or have ever made in your life. Many blessings to you and to your family. In Jesus' name, amen.